All right, so thanks a lot, Rodrigo, for the introduction. And first of all, let me thank the organizers, Jesko, Rodrigo, and Dimitri and others for inviting me to come here again. And it's a pleasure to be here. So I will continue on the same topic that Xenophon introduced in his first talk very nicely, namely transport in strongly correlated low-dimensional models, where there's a lot of discussion about the role of integrability in describing that and the theorist's obsession about Rudel weights, as I would like to call it. Now, in this talk, I will also be a 25% experimentalist and also talk a little bit about how one can possibly observe both Rudel weights and then also diffusion constants in experiments, but not so much in realistic materials, but in quantum simulators. And that will be, let me see what's happening. Yeah, so this will be roughly the outline of the talk. So I will try to cover two topics. First of all, continue to talk about transport and linear response. In Xenophon, mostly talked about the model that is dearest to most people in this field, namely XXZ spin 1/2 models that has been studied in fantastic detail. But there is, of course, a related model that is equally important in correlation physics, and that's the Fermi-Hubbard model. And it has attracted a little less attention, partly because some aspects are harder to solve than in XXZ chains, both from numerical point of view and from Beta Ansatz point of view. I'd like to shift the focus a little bit to that and tell you what, until 2 weeks ago, would have been the status of understanding regarding existence of Rudel weights and diffusion. And then you will hear that there's interesting recent developments on the question of diffusion in these models coming from the Amsterdam, Trieste, Vancouver crowd of people. Then after that, I would like to argue that most of the experiments that Xenophon described actually work with spin systems, but alternatively, we can try to find experiments that work with Fermi-Hubbard models directly. And that is usually more difficult to do in solid-state systems, but in fact, the ultra-cold quantum gas people provide us naturally with these systems, and we have a relatively simple proposal of how to measure Rudel weights and to hopefully even demonstrate the coexistence of ballistic channels, let's say thermal transporters ballistic in both XXZ and 1D Fermi-Hubbard, and a presumably diffusive channel in charge of spin. Okay. So then, the reason why I really want to talk about this is because some crucial ideas of that led to this paper here together with Tomasz Brosen and Christoph Karasch actually came out of a discussion here in Natal 2 years ago. So I felt I should probably mention that. Okay, and then the second part will be about experiments with ultra-cold atomic gases that already exist, that don't probe transport in linear response, but that probe transport far from equilibrium. The setup is here that you place particles in some central region and then remove the trapping potential and let the whole cloud expand. And there is fun aspects related to transient dynamics, so you can use that to even cool a quantum gas by letting it expand, which is perhaps a bit, or partially cool it, I should say more precisely, which is a bit counterintuitive. And if I have time, I'll talk a little bit about how one can use this dynamical dilution process in 1D to get access to beta rapidities in an actual experiment. So usually beta rapidities are a bit of a theoretical concept, and we work with that, but it's not something that you would usually measure in an experiment. But if you do something like that and wait long enough and look at the right quantities, then you can actually one-to-one extract the root densities. Okay, so the pointer isn't quite doing what it's supposed to do. This is the team of people. So every time that you work with experimentalists, there's a large group of people. Those are the people who contributed to the second part from Emanuel Boss group. Monika Eilutzburger here is the leading postdoc on that team. Sebastian Scherk is the leading PhD student from Munich. And then the work from the numerical side on that part was done by my student Jan Stolp and Jacek Herbruch, who's now at the University of Tennessee. And all the stuff that I'm going to present in the first part is a collaboration with Christoph Karasch, who's now at Berlin. Dante Kennis also at FU Berlin, and then Tomasz Brosen from Ljubljana. Okay, so I can go quickly over the first slides, which Xenophon already did a fantastic job of introducing. So in this business of linear response, we typically look for unusual conservation laws that tell us they have to be local. The simplest one are energy and particle number, and Xenophon said that there is typically in these models a third one, which would be the energy current or something very closely related to that. And that gives rise to the existence of a true Drude peak here at zero frequency. The extreme case is where the whole weight is in this Drude peak, but we can also have situations where there's also stuff at finite frequencies, and that is also an interesting question that I'll talk about a little bit in the introductory part. And then, as Xenophon said, the way to tell whether there's a Drude weight, if you can't exactly calculate that, is to use these Mazur inequalities to get lower bounds. Okay, so now let me quickly review what some of the aspects that Xenophon already talked about for the XXZ model as a start, sort of primer to what's going to be coming next. So we know that in this case, the energy current is always exactly conserved for any magnetization or parameters of this model. So we always have a perfectly ballistic thermoconductor. So that's an old story. And it's been calculated exactly already in 2002. The story that theorists have been fighting over for probably 20 years or so or longer is the question of Drude weights. So here the crucial breakthrough came in Thomas Brosen's paper. As Xenophon said, the story becomes non-trivial once we go to zero total magnetization. So then we know that the spin current itself is obviously not conserved. All the typical local conserved charges that are symmetric don't contribute in the Mazur inequality. And then Tomas and collaborators in A discovered a whole family of quasi-local charges and showed that indeed in this regime here, this is the anisotropy, that there is indeed a leading ballistic contribution right here. So that's been the first major conceptual breakthrough. But then you see, okay, there's other parameter regimes. There's still the Heisenberg point, and we haven't heard about that yet. So at that point, it seems that there's no lower bound to the Drude weight. And in that sense, it's probably zero. That's also consistent with most of the numerics, but it's hard to tell. And more recently, in a couple of papers that started with Markus Niederich in 2011, and then was continued in this Nature Communication from Tomasz's group, and again with Marco, and a student, I guess, from Ljubljana, they pointed out that there is arguments based on bounding diffusion constants from below by using the curvature of Drude weights in integrable models that tell you that at SU2 symmetric points, there might be something like superdiffusion. And that's one of the more recent developments that probably we'll hear about in this conference from maybe Draco Bodenades later. And that's a challenge for us numerical people to go back to what we did in the past and see, now that we have perhaps more clearer predictions of what to expect, to see if this can actually be extracted from numerical simulations as well. Okay, so then we have the third regime. So this particular special point here, delta equal 1, is the second one. And then if you go into the regime that sits right here, then there's more or less conclusion that it's very clear that there's no Drude weights, there's no lower bounds, they all vanish here. And essentially all the numerical data that we have would point to a DC conductivity here that at finite frequencies is well-behaved, it has a well-behaved low frequency limit, and that would mean that here we have a DC conductivity and through that also diffusion. Yeah, so that's probably the situation. And that gives rise to this interesting situation now that if we were able to go into that regime here in a given experiment, then if we didn't have to worry about phonons or impurities, we could have the situation that even though we might naively think it's the same excitations that carry energy and spin, that here we still have a ballistic thermoconductor, but spin transport would be diffusive. And that is one of the goals that we are trying to get the experimentalists called gases to do, to show that this can actually happen. It's much harder, of course, in condensed matter and solid state systems, because then you have to worry about relaxation times. Okay, now how do you do that? Yeah, let me skip. This is just numerical examples for all these scenarios. Yeah, then perhaps first a word about experiments. We already heard that that there's a lot of work done on thermal conductivity, which is the easier quantity in solid state physics here in quantum magnets. Then Xenophon already mentioned these beautiful time-resolved experiments on the same sort of materials. Here we have no clear proof from the experiments that there is anything like ballistic transport, and I also don't know any clear theoretical prediction that would tell us how we would have to extract the deuterate from this data. Yeah, so even if you think that this is relevant and that it's not entirely screened by scattering with phonons or impurities, it's something that probably the theorists have not fully worked out yet. But there's at least one experiment that was done with Bose-Habart model systems in optical lattices that if you go to infinitely strong local interactions maps to spin-Mohr half systems, that's equivalent to hardcore bosons. So the physical particles are actually strongly interacting. For theorists, they trivially map to spinless fermions. And then if you do this non-equilibrium experiment, you see that you can't distinguish from the experimental data whether you have free fermions or strongly interacting bosons. And in that sense, that's the so far the only experimental example that shows ballistic transport but in non-equilibrium. Okay, so how can we do better? So our idea was that we have to give up on XXZ. And the way to probe things that is natural in cold gases, because they have a sensitivity to local densities, is to not measure the conductivity directly, but think about diffusion in this phenomenological sense, that we create a density perturbation in either the particle density or the magnetization density or the energy density, and then simply monitor as a function of time how that density is spread out throughout the system. So you know that that there is Einstein relations that relate DC conductivities to diffusion constants. So the way that is usually quoted would be down here. So that's the diffusion constant here, DC conductivity divided by the corresponding susceptibility. But there is a generalization to make this whole thing time dependent, and that's written down here that I first learned from one of Robin's papers, but it's probably also known in older papers, I suppose. I wrote it down for infinite temperature, and that tells you that the width of this local perturbation is a double integral over the current correlation function. And now you can stare, in particular, it's also a time-dependent relation. You can stare and try to recover all the known cases. So for instance, if you have a diffusive system, then the first integral must have a finite area under its curve, so that will be diffusion. So here I get the diffusion constant times the second integration that gives time. So then I have sigma squared is 2 times diffusion constant times time, so that would be the typical diffusive behavior. If we have a ballistic system, then that function will ultimately level off at a constant, so I get 2 time integrations that at long time give simply the constant, which is the deuterate times t squared. Yeah. So that would be here. And that's probably fairly obvious, but it's a bit underappreciated that if you do this experiment, then and if you put the system into a ballistic situation, then you can directly extract the deuterate. Yeah, so this will be one of the goals here. So let me first show you that this recovers what we know for XXE. So here's data from a paper with from this paper with Tomasz and Christoph Karasz. So first of all, we have two sets of data curves here. So blue is actually what these little wave packets do, and then red is the double integral over the corresponding current correlation function. And as you see, everything sits nicely on top of each other. You also see that numerically, it's for reasons that we don't understand yet fully, it's a bit harder to get to long times with these density perturbation expansions a little bit. The upper panel is spin, the lower panel is energy. This is here for delta 1/2. That's in the, this one here is 1.5, so that's in the easy axis regime. So for spin, we expect that we have ballistic transport here. So this comes out. The exponent is clearly t squared. And then here, we would expect diffusive behavior. And to the degree that we can't get to infinitely long times, that looks diffusive. If you go to large values of delta, then the time scale that you need to see diffusion actually becomes much shorter. And this has all been done by us and other people. And then there is fairly robust evidence that this should give the diffusion constant at long times. Then energy is always ballistic, as you can see here. Now the insets show what the comparison would be of just looking at the prefactors extracted from these two curves and compare that to known stuff. So for the spin deuterate, that would compare to Tomasz's and Ine's results here from this PIL. So that's in fairly good agreement, minding that we have only finite time resolution. And this is a comparison to Andreas Klümper's and Sakai's old paper from 2003, where they calculated 2002 and 2003, where they calculated the thermal deuterate across the entire parameter regime. So this, in fact, shows that if you make these perturbations small enough, then we get precisely the true weights. So now, as I said, in solid state systems, typically there is phonons, there's impurities, so we have beautiful quantum magnets, and the thermodynamics is often well described, and we can also have access to their excitations. But it's sort of impossible to induce thermal transport, for instance, unless you talk to the phonons first, so unavoidably they have to play a role. And then it's not so clear how to whether we would expect anything like that at all. And that's why we thought we should perhaps turn to the Fermi-Hubbard model. Yeah, and the Fermi-Hubbard model, a bit provocatively, is maybe relevant for some materials. I mean, it's a simple one-band model, and often there's more bands that play a role anyways. It's sort of the parent Hamiltonian that we used to derive the Heisenberg model, for instance, by going to large U over T naught. But it's one-to-one realized in deep optical lattices. Okay, so that's a deep optical lattice. And what we would need the experimentalists to do is to make use of the recent significant progress with local site resolution that goes under the name of fermionic quantum gas microscopes. So what that means is you can both locally measure and address the atomic number up to parity. So this is an example of a 2D Fermi-Hubbard model. What you see here is essentially positions of atoms with small fluctuations. There's one atom here, that's a Mott insulator. And then there is a metallic region in between. And then in the center, there's another Mott insulator that appears to be empty because in this particular way of measuring it, double occupancies vanish. So it's not a Mott insulator, sorry, it's the band insulator that sits in the center. So that has been done in 6 or 7 groups right now. And the beauty is they can also tune this these systems to 1D. And that's the regime where we would expect to recover the physics related to integrability and stuff. In fact, there's already one 1D experiment from the Munich group, from Garching, and at least one unpublished result from Markus Greiner's group where he did exactly what we want to do, namely punch a hole in the system and do it such that punching a hole into the system excites charge density and energy density or spin density at the same time. That's something we have to think about a little bit. But Markus is a bit biased right now to looking at spin charge separation. Yeah, this is one of the things that everybody knows should be present in 1D systems, but that requires to go to very low temperatures typically. Whereas the beauty here is, as we know, that very high temperatures is just about sufficient. So we heard about infinite temperature. I would just be happy with temperature scales the order of bandwidth or something, or even less. Because the physics fundamentally probably doesn't change. That is another reason why this plays to the advantages of these experiments that are hard to cool down. So it's hard to go into the regime where the Heisenberg model would ever play a role, but it's easy to see the non-universal high-temperature physics. Okay, so that is a summary of, again, what I would have said is the understanding of transport in the 1D Hubbard model. Until about 2 or 3 weeks ago. So we're going to stick to half filling. So at half filling, most numerical work and also analytical bounds would tell you that there is no ballistic contribution. This is a numerical calculation that we did with a postdoc from Jülich, Robin Steinigewig, Michelsen, and Deretier. And you see a typical exponential, you see a power law decay, which is the typical behavior in an integrable model for the Drude-Weyl to decay. That's exactly what you expect from eigenstate thermalization hypothesis. There's a nice insight that came up 5 years ago or so that initially we were staring at this exact ionization data and it's typically small system sizes. But in fact now, if you interpret the Drude-Weyl as a measure of the fluctuations of the current in eigenstates, then we can argue with ETH that it should be power law decay in integrable models and exponential decay in non-integrable models. And that's consistent with all the data that we had for decades from exact ionization. Okay, so that's nothing new. Then the interesting question is really, what do we expect for charge transport here about whether it's diffusive or not? And here's an example for the diffusion constant as a function of time. So that means you integrate over the current correlation function for different system sizes. And diffusion would mean that this integral converges to a constant. Now, and you see, okay, if we crank up to the degree that we can handle here, is this particular method, it's a pure state method called dynamical typicality, then you see, okay, this seems at least consistent with this behavior. So that led us to conclude that the data as of then was consistent with diffusion. But then again, I have to put an exclamation mark here because of this recent papers here that say that the observation of superdiffusion that people believe is applies to the Heisenberg model, which is SU2 symmetric, should also carry over to other SU2 symmetric models. So that's an open challenge now to the numerical people again to go back and see if we can do better than this here. But as of now, we would say, okay, this is probably a diffusive conductor, but maybe a superdiffusive conductor. Okay, so then the other natural transport channel that is very different in this model is energy or thermal transport. At half-filling, there is no difference because the Seebeck coefficient here vanishes. And that here is was known, of course, from this paper by Xenophon, Neff, and Peter Preloschek, that this must be a ballistic thermal conductor. And they had an estimate from Mazur bounds for infinite temperature. And what we did first in this paper, and then Christoph Karasch extended this quite a bit with new improvements in time-dependent DMRG, was to calculate the whole temperature dependence. So what you see here is a blue and a red curve. The blue curve is U over T naught is 8. The red curve is U over T naught is 12. And then you see two dashed lines, and that is the thermal Joule debate calculated by Andreas Klümper and Sakai from back then for the Heisenberg model. And we have to rescale this, the axis properly to see that. And then you see that you would typically, as a function of temperature, if you make U over T naught large enough, two regimes, so one where the numerical data sits back on the Heisenberg prediction here, and then minimum, and then it goes back up to a second maximum that comes from a contribution from predominantly charged excitations. So here we would have the regime where quantum magnets play a role. Then if you go to higher temperatures, ultimately the description breaks down and you have to remember that you came from an electronic model. By that time, your crystal is melted, so it plays no role in solid state, possibly. It's also perhaps the reason why I said, okay, infinite temperature is a question, but Xenophon argued, okay, the behavior will not qualitatively change here. But you see that then you go into this regime where charge is the relevant carrier of energy. And that is precisely, again, the reason why if you want to see something, it's actually easier to go to optical lattices because that's what they can easily measure and access. Okay, yeah, so now the question is, can this coexistence of a ballistic energy or thermal channel with a diffusive or possibly super diffusive channel of charge be observed in an experiment, which would be a nice demonstration of demonstration experiment of something that is very unusual. That wouldn't exist in a Luttinger liquid. That wouldn't exist in a usual Fermi liquid, where the type, the qualitative type of transport is always tied to each other. So there's no Fermi liquid that has ballistic thermal transport and diffusive charge transport. And in Luttinger liquids, everything is typically ballistic anyways. So here we have a nice prediction from integrability about a non-universal microscopic behavior here. And at the same time, we want to observe true debates. Yeah, and the idea is, as I said, simple. We just follow the same idea of making a sufficiently small perturbation in the system in the local density. And then we measure the related densities as a function of time. So now here's the catch. The experiments can easily measure charge density. That's what they are designed for. But they can't easily measure kinetic energy. So kinetic energy requires that you locally measure expectation values of C dagger I, CI plus 1. And there is no technique yet that does this reliably and with sufficient resolution, which means that the easiest ballistic channel is not accessible yet in these experiments. But then we turned, and that's the thing that came out of the discussion here in Natal, but then we said, okay, we can play a little trick. We don't necessarily have to stay at zero magnetization. We can stay at half filling, but then spin imbalance the whole system. If I spin imbalance the system, I break SU2 symmetry, then the spin transport, just like Heisenberg models, has to become ballistic because then the spin current overlaps with the first non-trivial conservation law here, which is something like the energy current. So then this means that spin will become ballistic. This is the data here. then you see this is the exponent, so they're fairly close to 2. There is charge, the behavior of charge is not probably not sensitive to breaking SU2 symmetry in the spin sector. That's our working assumption. And we assume that this actually will remain diffusive. And the data up to the times that we could reach here is at least conclusive or indicative that this is not entirely unreasonable. So that would mean that you don't even have to expand to terribly long times, but then you see the qualitative differences here. The exponent for charge doesn't clearly saturate at 1, which would be required for diffusion. It's not saturated at all yet on these timescales. So that is still, from the numerical point, not a proof that you really have diffusion. But fortunately, the typical timescales on which these experiments live, under which they undergo coherent dynamics, go up to probably t over t naught or t over 1 over t naught of 10. Yeah? So the experiments will be able to do a factor of 2 or even 3 better. And whether this works or not is essentially a question of resolution capabilities. Yeah? And at the same time, the prefactor here would be the Drude weight in the spin sector. Yeah? So that would be the 2 messages. First of all, measure the Drude weight here. And then second of all, see this difference in different channels. Okay, how am I doing on time? Sorry? Okay, perfect. Then, yeah. Okay, so again, the experimental playground would be these fermionic quantum gas microscopes. There's no cooling needed here, so that plays to the advantage. And then the time scales are perfectly within the experimental capabilities. Okay, so that wraps up the first part of the talk about the transport properties in the Hubbard model and this proposal of how to measure the Drude weight that we have annoyed experimentalists now with for 25 years. And that will probably be possible in cold gases. Okay, so now I want to turn to a related but slightly orthogonal direction, still the same model, but non-equilibrium transport. And the same in the setup will be the following. We imagine that we initially trap particles. Experimentalists use harmonic traps. We prepare them in some desired initial state. Then we remove the trapping potential and let them move around in a smooth potential landscape. We will have the contribution of all particles to this transport problem. It's not only the particles that sit at the Fermi edges, but really everything contributes. There's various interesting things. So this first experiment here that I mentioned earlier is the one where you see that for very strongly interacting bosons, that they behave exactly like non-interacting fermions, which is expected, but is demonstrated in this experiment. So an example of ballistic non-equilibrium mass transport. There's fun non-equilibrium stuff, so in the same setup where you're in real space don't see any difference between fermions and bosons. If you look into momentum space, you see that the bosons dynamically quasi-condense here. This was also then confirmed in experiments. And then there's earlier work also from the Munich group on this sort of setup in 2D where they observed the diffusion or interpreted their data as diffusion in the core and then crossover to ballistic tails. So that's something that is relatively, there's a decently large set of experiments that have done that already, also from, besides this Munich experiment, also from David Weiss's group. So first I want to deviate a little bit from the question of transport and just show you one fun example of transient dynamics that we stumbled over in 2009. That's how I got to know all these guys, and it took eventually, well, apparently 9 years for the experiment to be set up and done. That's about the patience that you need. So the sketch for to understand what's going on here is the following. So we're talking about Fermi-Hubbard model. We imagine now for simplicity that we have a box potential, particles here, nothing out here. And we go to densities or the constraints such that we have a mixture of doublons, so 2 particles spin up and spin down on a side, and singly occupied sides. So that could either be by making density large and going into equilibrium, or by engineering in states that product states. That's what the experimenters actually prefer to do. And now we could ask what is going to happen as we open the trap. So you know that when U is much larger than J, so I switch to J being tunneling now because that's sort of a convention in the optical lattice community, that the single atoms would be, if they're set at the boundary, would tunnel away with just 2j is the fastest velocity. But the pairs have an effective tunneling matrix element of j squared over u. So if there's a pair at the end, then that would just very slowly move on very long time scales, eventually dissolve into singlons. But even that is not entirely true. So you would expect that everything is blocked by the fact that just by probability, there's most at high density, there's mostly doublons sitting here at the boundary. But then there is a way around that the system can explore. Energy is conserved, so it can explore the entire phase space, if you wish, for its dynamics to make something happen. And there is a first order process that simply conserves energy where you move this guy inside, which means that effectively the doublon moves inside, and one singlon has moved to the outside. Yeah, so that looks like this. So that looks like that. And that would mean that just by opening the trap, something fun is happening. All the single atoms move away quickly, and they move away quickly as if the doublons were not there, because they can just exchange positions with them in first order hopping processes. And then the doublons in the core pile up. And if you tune U to make it large enough, then this can even be, in a core region, a perfect band insulator. That's where the name came from. Alejandro Muramazzo coined the expression, he called it quantum distillation back then in this joint paper, because it separates parts of the cloud that carry all the kinetic energy from a region that is only interaction energy, and that would then, in the the closer you get to a band insulator, a low entropy region here. And back then that was an important topic and called gases to have schemes to cool down portions of, to cool down portions of your gas, and that's how we sold it. But in fact, it's just a nice transient effect that we were hoping that they would observe. So then, just to show you that this also works in numerics, here's stuff from a recent paper with Jacek, where we did this on letters, but it's the same story. This is initial profile here. Then you see, okay, the density indeed goes up and piles up to 2 here. Doublons move inside, singlons move outside. That's the doublon density that goes to the center here. And the signals just move out here and reflect at the boundaries, because this is a small simulation box. But you see the main point that the signals move out ballistically and the doublons remain here in the core. So eventually, at very long times, they will also slowly follow. And that's why this is a transient phenomenon, but in principle, this should work. Okay, then a first experiment did that with bosons from David Weiss's group. They had a possibility of measuring the full density, singlons and doublons individually. What you see is three traces of experimental data that's, in fact, simulations that Marcus Rigol did. You see that this is time equals zero. The peak density in the core reduces, and I should say that these experiments are typically averages over many 1D systems. You see that there is tails building up here. And then when you look at the contributions from singlons, you see that the tails exclusively come from singlons, and that the singlon density peak really goes down quickly. And for the doublons, they essentially remain in the center. Yeah, so this is what we were saying. There should be something like a dynamical separation of singlons and doublons, which ideally really means that the singlons move out of a region that had originally a mixture of doublons and singlons. Now, the problem in this experiment, or the thing that they couldn't quite do is, this is rubidium, so they were restricted a bit in the interaction strength, and we need interaction strengths to be large to clearly separate the timescales for a decay of doublons into singlons and the propagation of singlons versus doublons. So that's why this density over here for the doublons also goes down, because doublons are partially converted into singlons. So it's not quite the regime yet that you want. And then it's bosons, and even if you were able to pile up bosons into a string of states that have 2 bosons per side, then that's still not a band insulator, it can still have fluctuations. So it wouldn't be able to cool the system as nicely as for fermions. So that's why the guys in Munich went back to fermions. The experiment in 1D. This is, in fact, done with potassium that does have a nice Feshbach resonance. So here we can tune interaction strength from 5 to 20, or even stronger. What you see is essentially a measure for the width of the cloud, for singlons, and then for the doublons. U equal 5, you see, okay, the singlons go out quickly. The slope here corresponds to 2 times j here is the fastest velocity, and the doublons very slowly follow. And if you go to U over j equal 20, the signals still go out quickly, but then have a mild tendency to decrease their radius. So that's the indication that is admittedly not as strong as we had hoped for of Doublon, of the Doublon core contracting. Now this is an integrated density over all the 1D systems, and you see initially there is both a contribution from doublons and singlons, and as we let the system expand, the singlons predominantly move out and the doublons decay a little bit here and expand very slowly. So that is probably, given the capabilities of these experiments, given the range that you can expand into and the resolution techniques that they have available, the best experimental evidence that this quantum dissertation happens here. Okay, so there was a slight detour going away from integrability. This effect doesn't rely at all on integrability. If I have 5 minutes or so, then I will briefly tell you about a second aspect that these expansion experiments can be used for, and that is using this for accessing the asymptotic regime that produces a very dilute gas, not by making the density adiabatically low, but by making it dynamically, by unitary time evolution low. So why is that important? If I take a 1D system and just make the density low, I will make it ultimately very strongly interacting, as opposed to 3D, where if I dilute the gas adiabatically, I make it very weakly interacting. In 1D, I have the opposite effect. So here, I don't want that. I want a situation where initially I have my trapped cloud, I let it expand, there is interactions and scattering going on, energy is in total conserved. And I'd like to think that at long times, I will recover some Hamiltonian, that is essentially a free Hamiltonian, because what the system does is it will use the scattering to velocity order itself. So in a classical picture, the fastest particles move at the front and the slower ones follow. And once that has happened, there's no scattering anymore, and I have produced a stationary infinite time momentum distribution function. And then you can ask, okay, what's the role of conservation laws? How will they constrain this object here? And what is the actual interpretation of this object? And what does it teach us about the initial state? And that is something that is introduced in Sutherland's book about beautiful models very early on, where he gives an interpretation of the rapidities and uses precisely this dynamical dilution or expansion thought experiment to say that the root densities here that enter when you calculate thermodynamics and beta ansatz is what is recovered if I do this experiment. So initially, I have a physical momentum distribution function. I let the gas expand, and then the physical momentum distribution function approaches the underlying root density here. Yeah, and that's a sketch here. That would be true for a finite system. So I have some sort of n of rho of root densities. There's a Fermi edge sort of behavior. And that thing is invariant because it's tied to the conservation laws of the system. Okay, so now we wanted to demonstrate that this can be done. It's something that is expected based on Sutherland's arguments. So we did two things. The first one was the direct measurement of the momentum distribution functions. Here for a slightly different situation, negative U and a spin imbalance system. The reason why we did that is historic reasons. And it leads to the fact that here we have, in the beta ansatz language, a number of minority fermions, many pairs, bound states in the system, and then an up, minus, and down, many unpaired fermions. So there's block-like Fermi distributions for the rapidities in the initial state. And then in principle, what you have to solve is you have your initial box, and you open the trap and expand your initial state in the eigenstates of the infinite system. And that is mathematically a difficult step. So this hasn't been solved yet. So what we did is to work around that. So we solved for the distribution of root densities in the finite box, which you can do by an open system size beta ansatz. Then use an assumption about about how everything gets broadened, because we need the infinite system size distributions. And then we compare that to a direct numerical measurement of DMRG. So that's here for the minorities. And you see, okay, this almost perfectly already sits on top of each other. The timescales to reach that are short. It's order of 10 over hopping here. And then for the delta n of k, the difference here that would measure the unpaired fermions, it's good and at the boundaries, but it's still sort of not approaching the final form here for the long wavelength contributions. So not surprising. So the point is that again, the reason why this is fast is again this quantum distillation, because here pairs and unpaired fermions also separate from each other through this mechanism, and that is probably the easiest experiment to measure the root density directly, because you don't have to wait for long. The reason why you don't have to wait for long is once the unpaired fermions have escaped from the initial cloud, they're just a non-interacting gas of unpaired fermions, and then they have a stationary N of K after this dynamical separation. And the same goes for the pairs that lag behind. If I make U over J large, then they're essentially hardcore bosons. So I end up, after a short time scale, having two gases of essentially non-interacting particles, and that's why these things become stationary reasonably fast. Now, unfortunately, most experimentalists have a bias to working with repulsive interactions, and there the two components will see each other for a very long time, so it's essentially impossible to get to the regime where the N of K would already be stationary. We also can't do that numerically. But I talked a bit about the question of how fast these clouds expand. There is an intermediate step that you can do. You can look at the velocities, so you measure the radius in this fashion, just as a second moment of the density, and then look at the prefactor in the regime that we want to go into, where we recover an effective non-interacting Hamiltonian, in the sense that I argued earlier in this asymptotic regime. This will go linearly, linear to t, and the prefactor then, this velocity squared, is just this average here over all group velocities weighted with the root density distribution. And what we did here is simply to check that if I plug in the beta ansatz prediction for these root densities, then I can calculate these velocities and compare again to what I expect from DMRG. So much is DMRG, and the lines through these, the solid lines is the essentially using this equation, and you see this works perfectly after relatively short time scales already. And the reason why that works after short time scales is that we are suppressing the contribution from small momenta because of this v squared, that is a sine squared. So it doesn't matter so much that these guys still have a lot of transients. It's more leading to the fact that this particular average that is accessible in experiments converges fast. So it's an indirect test, but it allows us to predict velocities directly from integrability. Okay, so the second part that was done in the experiment that also looked at this quantum distillation did just that. So now we are going to, or not quite that, I'm going to tell you what is missing. It's actually something missing on the theory side. They also looked at initial states that are at half filling with a random mixture of spin ups and spin downs, but in total spin balanced, repulsive interactions. And then again, if you let the system evolve, it will expand. And at the same time, I generate doublons in the center because they realize, okay, I'm a product state, I'm not locally in equilibrium. And then what you observe for the expansion velocities is typically these circles here, that's the experimental data, a very weak minimum here at intermediate interactions, and then you recover a very fast expansion at strong U. So why is this so weak? And the reason is this averaging over, over all possible spin distributions. You can only generate doublons, and these heavy doublons are the reason why in a simple two-component picture this gas becomes slower here. You can only produce as many as you have spin-up, spin-down neighbors here. The Néel state, which has the most of these spin-up and spin-down neighbors, is the line here. So that's the lowest minimum that fermions can produce. And we have in the experiment is an average of all possible of these distributions. That's the red line that we did numerically. And the experimental data is reasonably close to that within error bars. Okay, so the main message here is this quantity can be measured. The experimentalists like these product states. There is this weak minimum, but essentially almost no effect of interactions here because of this averaging. And it's very different from bosons. Yeah, so bosons is an earlier experiment that shows this very deep minimum here. And that can be easily understood. So first, the experimental colleague said, okay, this is cool. I essentially see no effect of interactions. It almost perfectly expands ballistically. So it looks like I've seen the difference between an integrable model and a non-integrable bosonic model. But that would be too simple-minded. The reason why we have this significant difference here is simply the fact that bosons have only one initial state that has particle one particle per side, but they can produce doublons across every single pair of neighboring particles. They can also produce higher side occupancies, which means that the interaction energy that is produced if I let the system evolve can in general be much larger for bosons here. These are the bosonic data points, velocity plotted as a function of a direction energy, and they just basically sit on an extrapolation of what the fermions do for different numbers of spin-up and spin-down pairs in the initial state, which simply tells you that, well, bosons can produce more interaction energy. Yeah, so that's right now the interpretation. And the reason why fermions can't do that is essentially a version of Pauli principle. So going back to this question of accessing the asymptotic regime, in principle, that's the quantity, this velocity that one could look at to indirectly measure the, or have a prediction for that from root densities. We haven't done that yet because now we have a non-equilibrium state in the initial box. So we can't play this intermediate game where we expand that. Or we could, but it's more complicated, where we expand that into beta ansatz eigenstates in the finite box. Ultimately, we need to expand that into eigenstates of the infinite system. And that's so far still open. Okay, so with that, I will wrap up and show you the summary. So I talked a bit about linear response transport behavior in the Hubbard model. I argued that it would be actually very nice to have an experiment that shows this coexistence of a ballistic spin or thermal channel with diffusive charge transport, diffusive in quotation marks, because maybe it's not diffusive, but super diffusive. And it should be actually realistic to even measure Drude weights in these optical lattice quantum gas microscopes. And then the second part is about non-equilibrium transport. I told you about this quantum distillation, dynamical separation of doublons from singlons, and then the argument that the asymptotic long-time regime is a way of looking at root densities in these experiments. Thank you for your attention.
Questions?
Yeah, thanks for this nice talk. So my question is about the dynamical typicality approach, which you mentioned among